and welcome to History by Hollywood, the podcast series examining the real events and people behind fact-based movies. This is episode 5 for Sunday, the 26th of March 2017, and today's movie is 1955's The Dambusters, directed by Michael Anderson and starring Richard Todd and Michael Redgrave in the leading roles. My name is Martin Darlington, and before I go any further, I just need to let you know that there's a few recording issues. There's a bit of flanging, particularly on my voice, in the opening minutes, but it does go away, so do please persevere. And now we'll go back to the intro I was doing, where I think I was about to say, and. And with me today is our first guest host, and I'm delighted to let you know that we have on board the presenter of the World War II podcast series, also co-host on Life of Caesar, which has now become The Life of Augustus, and The Life of Alexander, and the Cold War podcast, and the philosophical series The Three Illusions, and as of last week, The BS Filter, which is a series looking at issues in current affairs, Ray Harris. Ray, welcome.
Thank you, Martin. Andrew, I really do appreciate it. I'm very excited to be here, to be your first guest, to talk about this particular movie, and I promise to either set the bar so high or so low for all your other guests that you won't forget me anytime soon.
Absolutely. Before we get into the meat of the show, we've got a couple of errata and updates. In the show notes to episode 4 and in the intro, we mentioned Ryan Stitt's Ancient Greece podcast, which tied in nicely with 300 we did last time out. That is a worthy recommendation. However, the podcast series that followed us on Twitter and we actually meant to plug was the Ancient Greece podcast, whose Twitter address is at Greece Podcast, all lowercase, and whose web address is www.greasepodcast.com. Lantern Jack, which is the very exotic name of the main presenter, has also just covered the Persian War, so you can get his perspective on the events we covered last time out by checking out his show. So apologies to Lantern Jack. Thanks for the follow. We've now given you a plug, and I have added his a link on the show notes to 300. And, Ray, you're going to do a bit of our listener feedback.
Excellent. Listener Jacob Morrison gave us some really useful feedback after our last episode on 300. Another great episode. Love the format. Hate the sounds in the middle of the clips. We agree with Jacob that the clips are... and those won't be seen a reappearance anytime soon, which surely deserves a...
And we heard from Mark Jackson, who's an old Twitter buddy of mine from bike racing, and he wrote us a very positive iTunes review in February, but I've only just noticed it. So
yeah,
a big
happens.
Thank you for that, Mark, and very sorry for the belated acknowledgement, but thanks a lot. And we also had Chai Town Paddy from Chicago commented that he'd heard about a rumored Peter Jackson remake of the Dambusters. He's absolutely right. There is one that's been in the offing for about 8 or 9 years, and I'm usually against these things, but the screenplay's been written by Stephen Fry, who will also appear as Barnes Wallace. And I've heard Fry interviewed, and he's adamant that they're even closer to the facts than the original. But the project's been stalled for several years whilst Peter Jackson makes things like, you know, King Kong and The Hobbit and all those. So it may not happen. But if it does, let's hope they tread carefully.
I'm sorry, I was just going to say this movie was fantastic, but I will put up with another version of it if it has Jackson and Fry involved. I love their work very much. Stephen Fry could read the phone book, as far as I'm concerned, and I will listen to it.
Yeah, I've a few audio books I've listened to with him narrating, mainly because it's him narrating.
Exactly.
Very, very clever guy. So, on with the show, and I do think we probably need to kick off with a little bit of Eric Coates' incredibly iconic music. So, the story of the movie. It was made in 1955, and it's based on both Paul Brickhill's book, The Dambusters, and Guy Gibson's book, Enemy Coast Ahead. It stars Richard Todd as Wing Commander Guy Gibson, VC, DSO and Bar, DFC and Bar, and Michael Redgrave as Barnes Wallace. It was directed by Michael Anderson, and as we mentioned earlier, Eric Coates wrote the theme music, which is just so familiar to a whole, well, several generations of war movie lovers and particularly British schoolboys. It was nominated for 2 Oscars and 4 BAFTA awards. It didn't win any, but it was seen as groundbreaking in its effects for the standards of the day.
As far as Paul Brickhill, an Australian journalist from the Sydney Sun, he joined the RAAF at the outbreak of World War II, became a Spitfire pilot, was shot down in Tunisia, and became a POW in Stalag Luft III in Silesia, mostly in southern Poland, and from where the outbreak, which became known as the Great Escape, occurred. Brickhill was part of the organization of the mass escape, although he failed to draw a winning ticket from the lottery to decide who would participate. He started writing his manuscript for the book, The Great Escape, whilst still incarcerated in the camp, which is pretty amazing. He went on to write the Dambusters and Reach for the Sky, a biography of Douglas Bader. Paul Brickhill died in 1991, age 75, but left us some of the most iconic stories of World War II. Quite possibly, he was able to get the likes of the surviving Dambusters and such enigmatic leaders as Bader to open up because he, quite frankly, was one of them. And I'm not sure if you had a chance to look into Douglas Bader's life, but pretty amazing story. He was a well-known pilot, lost his legs, was able to go back into the fighting even after that. And supposedly, one of the reasons he was such a good pilot was because, you know, when you have to deal with the G-forces, the blood drains and goes through the body. But he didn't have any legs, so there wasn't much of a distance for the blood to go to. So supposedly he could handle the G-forces better. Well, eventually he shot down, and he also will spend some time in Stalag Luft III. But he kept escaping so many times that they actually had to move him to a more secure camp. And he was a prisoner until he was freed by the United States First Army in April of 1945. So he's another amazing person you'll probably cover in the future.
Absolutely. I mean, Reach for the Sky is another one that will be on the long-term list, definitely. A fascinating character, Douglas Bader, quite a spiky character. Possibly worth remembering, he lost his legs in an accident before the war, showboating, beating up the flying clubhouse where his girlfriend was. So, but incredibly determined guy, and there's some amazing stuff. And I believe the Germans confiscated his legs because he escaped that many times. It was like when everyone turned in, they took his legs off him. So you don't need him in bed. But the other thing is Richard Todd, who stars as Guy Gibson. He's got his own incredible story. He was born in Ireland in 1919. He became an actor, but at the outbreak of the war, joined the army and ended up as an officer in the 7th Parachute Battalion. At D-Day, he was one of the first soldiers to land in Normandy. And when, after the war, he appeared in the film The Longest Day, he had the slightly surreal experience of playing Major John Howard of the Oxfordshire and Buckinghamshire Light Infantry, speaking to another actor who was playing Lieutenant Richard Todd. So he was acting someone, speaking to someone acting himself. He was also, and this, I only found this out during the research for the show, he was the first choice for James Bond, but there were scheduling issues. He had other commitments that year, so the role went to Sean Connery. I think Richard Todd would have made an incredibly good James Bond, but then so did Sean Connery, so I suppose we shouldn't complain. Just for the reality background, in addition to the 2 books used by the movie, we used James Holland's excellent Dambusters, The Race to Smash the Dams, 1943. Holland draws on extensive official records, personal accounts from both the British and the German side of the events. There are also some very good TV documentaries out there, in particular Dambusters Declassified. You can watch on YouTube. It's presented by actor and aviation nut Martin Shaw. But the background, because we're not quite going to go where you and Cameron go, right? In drilling down and doing the full detailed background. But basically, Barnes Wallace was the deputy chief designer at Vickers Aircraft Manufacturer. He designed the R-100 airship. He was a large part of the design of the Wellington bomber, which we'll come on to shortly. But he wrote a report in 1941 on the benefits of attacking the Ruhr dams, which were famous throughout Germany as models of engineering achievement. Mm-hmm. For example, the Kaiser had been due to visit the opening of the Myrna Dam in 1914, but the outbreak of World War I prevented it.
Yeah, Wallace's first idea was to use an earthquake bomb that would be dropped from a relatively high level, penetrate the earth to get a great depth before exploding. That makes sense. After the Dambusters raid was over, Wallace would indeed develop such a bomb, codenamed Tall Boy, more on that later, and even a larger bomb, the Grand Slam. The Ruhr was undergoing constant attack by the Allied bombing forces, as were other industrial areas of Germany. And as some of the members of my World War II podcast will know, the famous Krupp family of Essen is in this area. And it was Germany's largest manufacturing armaments producer. It was owned by a single person, obviously. It was in a woman's name because of marriage and stuff like that, but she was the richest person in Germany. And it was the Krupp family, the Krupp director, Gustav Krupp, who said to Hitler, look, you're going to kill all these slaves anyway. Why not work them to death? So a lot of them were brought to Essen and put into factories and other menial tasks, stuff like that. So that was as far as this particular area goes, there's a lot of slave labor. And that was the Krupp's idea, not Hitler's, not the SS or anyone else. He's the one who suggested it. And Hitler saw the wisdom, if you will, of that and allowed all those prisoners to be sent to the Ruhr Valley and to Essen itself.
So Gustav Krupp, basically nice guy then,
But if you think about it, it's cruel, but it's efficient. And we always talk about how efficient the Germans are. It was something that appealed to Hitler. Look, you're going to kill them. Why not work them to death as opposed to just shooting them or starving them? And it was just a win-win for some very bad guys.
Yeah, absolutely. The whole bombing campaign, incredibly controversial. But, you know, I think as we've agreed in the past talking about such things, you cannot judge, and we'll come back to this later in this show, mm-hmm. You can't judge people in history by our modern moral and ethical standards because they evolve and change over the years. And
absolutely.
No doubt there will be people down the line will look at some of the practices we have today and think, oh, barbarians.
Yeah.
But a very good point about the bombing campaign. First of all, it was the only way that Britain could really hit back at Germany for the first 2 or 3 years of the war. And also, those 88mm anti-aircraft guns couldn't be moved to the Russian front and used as anti-tank guns, which they did become. If people think about movies, they might have seen A Bridge Too Far or the far more recent Brad Pitt film Fury.
Right.
You know, you hear the tankers shouting, oh my God, it's an 88, because they were scared of the 88 anti-aircraft gun being used in its anti-tank role.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you said there were 100,000 of them around the Ruhr trying to protect Germany and the big cities?
Yeah, there were a lot of them, and trying to protect the factories, the camps and stuff like that. Obviously, Krupp's home, which got bombed. It was a massive castle that gets bombed as well. Yes, but they had a ton of these guns around because obviously this was the lifeblood of the German army.
Sure. Another very good point made by James Holling's book, and something I'd not thought about, particularly considering the international representation in the RAF during World War II, is the huge advantage Britain had with Australia, Canada, South Africa, Rhodesia, New Zealand in particular. Huge open areas, often with far more stable and clement weather than the UK,
mm-hmm.
where they could train their aircrew completely out of reach of German or Japanese interference. So we had these Empire flying training schools where people would sometimes be sent from Britain to Canada or to Australia, train there, then they get shipped back to Britain as fully trained, ready to go operational pilots.
Right.
And it's a huge advantage because the Germans had to train all their people in Germany with our bombers flying overhead and you know, when the Russians knocking at the door towards, you know, the later part of the war. So back to the movie, and the very opening scene is Barnes Wallace firing marbles in his garden on an elongated bathtub with his children carrying out measurements for him. Apparently it's absolutely true. That is how it all started. Then the village doctor comes round, and we've had a bit of a to and a fro over this and a discussion, and he says, he's talking to the doctor. He's basically telling him all his ideas about the Ruhr dams, and he's showing him maps and talking about the earthquake bombs. And now he's got this new idea that would work much better. And they talk about a committee that he's got to go and speak to the next day. And when we get to the committee, he asks the chairman, who is very supportive. He says, look, the original idea you asked me to consider, which we now know was about the earthquake bomb,
right,
I've realized it won't work. It probably won't work. So I've got this new idea. And eventually they agree to give him some more time. Then he meets a bit of a old duffer who's being a bit of a buffer from the Ministry of Aircraft Production, and says, I need to borrow a Wellington. And he says, what possible reason could I give them to persuade you to lend them one of those? And he says, maybe if you told them I designed it. And of course, the next scene is Matt Summers flying a Wellington for him. So how much is that is true? Well, you know, as you said, it's almost certainly safe. He's probably known the family for a long time, this doc. But I just think security, I think Barnes Wallace would have been very aware of security. But I think the movie uses this as a device to tell us the background, the lead up, where he is and where he's got to go.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. It's like, you don't just go around blurting the, hey, I've got the secret plan to inflict damage on our enemy. You don't just go around talking about that outside in your front yard. But because this doctor is taking care of their kids in the movie, he's probably known this man for a very long time. It probably doesn't get much safer than that. But still, you would think they would be a little more paranoid and say, hey, come inside. I want to talk to you about something. But nope, right out there in the front yard, just blurting it all out, doing his experiments in the front yard. A little weird, but I think you're right. I think it was a device in the film just to convey some information. And sometimes you have to do that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. We also have discovered that actually Barnes Wallace didn't design the Wellington bomber. What he did is design the geodetic frame around which the bomber was built. And what this was, it's basically a trellis framework, which rather than having a beam from which the framework comes out, the framework follows the aerodynamic shape of the aircraft. So it makes it very light because there's no central spar, but very light, but incredibly strong. So Wallace worked on the internal structure whilst his boss, Rex Pearson, who was Vickers' chief designer, he did the general layout. And, you know, as you say, wow, it worked.
Yeah, I mean, he might not have been the one who developed it, but he had enough inside connections and they probably respect him enough to loan him one, even though, you know, they're probably counting every single plane they have to try to inflict as much damage as they can on Nazi Germany. But they trusted him, they believed in him, so they loaned him one, and obviously it worked out for the best.
Yeah, I mean, he continues to develop the ideas with the bouncing bomb using test tanks, which would have, they were a submarine testing tank that they used. That would have meant they can't be used for other stuff. Then they tried a prototype version from Mosquito. It works well, but there's still resistance. And it kind of shows a lot, the movie shows quite a lot of people going, oh. But then, of course, we're only seeing his brilliant idea that we now know worked.
Right.
Because they must have had people coming up every week saying, I've got this brilliant idea to end the war in 3 days. And it involves, I don't know, whatever, you know, crazy ideas. So you can kind of understand their skepticism. But this is interesting. I knew nothing about this. You mentioned something about the bomb skipping.
Yeah.
Or skip bombing.
Right. Well, first of all, yeah, the War Department and various officials were getting crazy ideas handed to them every day. I remember this one video on YouTube where there's this giant, picture this giant wooden wheel, and it has like fireworks taped all around it. So when the fireworks go off, it turns the wheel and you can roll it at the enemy. And at the center of it, it has this big explosion. So the fire is almost like bottle rockets. It turns the wheel and then explodes. I mean, just, and of course it doesn't work. It turns on its side. It falls flat down and it blows up and it almost kills the people who are trying it out. But they got these crazy ideas every day. And here's just one more idea that seems far fetched. But I did some, I did some research into this because I've heard several different things. Now, Operation Chastise that we're going to be talking about is in May of 43, But theoretically, the Americans in the Pacific trying to deal with Japanese shipping were using skip bombing. You fly low, you fly in fast, you drop your bomb, obviously ahead of the target. It bounces and you get more, you're able to pull away faster because you're going to get more of a, you're going to get more distance from your bomb. And that way they would slam into the side of the Japanese ship. So that way you don't have to bomb directly on the ship. You can just fly up to it, you know, on its side, drop your bomb, let it skip across the surface, slam into the ship, and then explode. So that really worked, and that was in March of 43. But supposedly, there's, and we'll talk about this later, Wallace, I think it's Wallace that talks about that he got the idea from Nelson. So who knows where the original idea came from?
Yeah, I mean, from what I've read, in the cannonball era of naval warfare, it was known that on a flat surface, on a flat sea, as calm sea, you could skip the cannonballs, but only from the lower deck guns. If you didn't from the higher deck guns, then the top deck, maybe the angle was too, and it would just go into the water. So, but there's no evidence. I don't think that Nelson actually did what Wallace did. But again, I can sort of forgive that. But back to the movie, and we have Wallace continually, it feels, being rebuffed and rejected. So eventually he asks Mutt Summers, Vickers' chief test pilot, to approach Sir Arthur Harris, known by history as Bomber Harris, for approval on the grounds that Mutt Summers really knows him. And he says, well, I'll give it a go, but don't blame me if he throws us both out of the window. But then once the films are seen, Harris appears to give it his grudging support. But then the next scene is Wallace is back home talking to his wife and says he's been told to drop the whole thing by Vickers, his employer, to which he responded by resigning. But then he speaks to the main civil servant liaison the next day and is told, well, who told you that? No, the whole thing's been given the green light. So it's a little bit sort of like, I mean, Barnes Wallace couldn't have known whether he was coming or going.
Right. But you've got to think that the speed of a scientist working, I mean, you just really get the sense that this guy just had ideas, and when he had an idea, he just wanted to jump on it. He wanted to move. The speed of politics and the speed of committees, especially during wartime, is a completely different animal. And yeah, so he decides to quit. And then by the time he decides to quit, they've already greenlit it. So he just has to give them enough time to let them examine what his proposal is. So anyway, in real life, Sir Arthur Harris was a strict disciplinarian. He was initially against the idea. He just didn't see the value of it. He was a very practical person. He wanted results. He didn't care about ideas. You know, what's this going to do for me? It was actually Sir Charles Portal, the Air, Sea, and Sea, who pushed for the idea, along with a much earlier version.
Much earlier time, yeah, the Admiralty.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So they wanted the idea as well, because you had smaller versions of this being used against ships. You had the Upkeep, which is a large bomb, and you had the Highball, a smaller bomb. So they're looking at a lot of different tactics here, and they're just trying to figure out what's the best way to proceed. Harris was also against the Pathfinder force earlier in the war, but to his credit, once he got on with it, he threw his considerable influence and intense personality behind it, and he certainly wanted to make it work. And again, Harris was very practical. If you could prove to him that something would get you results, he would back you to the hilt. And if he's on your side, that's great. And if he's your enemy, that's bad, because he had a very intense personality. Barnes Wallace did resign from Vickers after his boss told him to concentrate on his main work. Oh, but this is interesting, because you were talking about this earlier. So he does quit after the Vickers boss tells him to get on with his main work. But again, it all gets worked out, and they do approve him go ahead to try this. And here's the thing: once he's given permission, because of various different factors, they've only got 2 months to form a squadron, train it, build the bombs, adapt enough Lancasters to fly them, and make this all work. So they're on a tight, tight schedule.
Yeah, it's almost like, be careful what you wish for. It's like, you reckon you can make this work? Yeah, okay, go ahead then. Oh, brilliant, thanks. By the way, you've got 2 months. What?
Yeah.
Man!
Let's see here.
Wow.
Now, and I did notice this when I was watching the movie. In the movie, the prototype bombs either look like they're superimposed or they're like a spherical in later shots. This was done by the censors on purpose in 1955 because obviously with the Cold War going on, the fear of war with the Soviets, this information about this type of bombing was classified until 1963. The actual upkeep bomb was cylindrical and much larger than shown being dropped at Reculver. So yeah, so they had to kind of fudge the facts a little bit for obvious security reasons.
Yeah, and of course in the movie there's no mention of the mechanism which span the cylinder bombs backwards at 500 RPM. Right. And that was a key part of getting the extra range. So you had to drop at an exact speed, 240 miles an hour they refer to. I would imagine the RAF then used knots as we do now, nautical miles an hour, but 240 miles an hour. At exactly, initially they thought 150 feet, and it had to be backspinning at 500 RPM. Mm. And then when that all comes in, then he's convinced it will work. So, I mean, there's a precision required here that just hadn't existed in air warfare up to that point.
Right.
And then, of course, then we cut to the formation of 617 Squadron, who were given their number actually a few days after they started forming. So we see Guy Gibson lands from his last trip of his third tour. Him and his crew plan to go into town and live it up, but then he's called to see the Air Officer Commanding 5 Group, Air Vice Marshal Ralph Cochran, who offers him one more trip. And I think Richard Todd played this brilliantly. He went, yes, of course, sir. What kind of trip? You know, he's like, what? Yeah. What? But it kind of fits with Gibson. I mean, the deal was you did the way the RAF worked on bomber tours, you did a 30-trip operational tour. Then you got a break, normally 4 to 6 months instructing in a flying school. Then you went back and did your second tour, which was 20 trips. Then you went back for another break. Well, he just kept skipping breaks, going, no, give me another tour. No, give me another tour. He had a real press-on attitude. And Harris, apparently, he was one of his rising stars.
Right.
So Gibson accepts, says his crew need a break from him, but then they all insist on going with him to look after him. As they say in the film. And he's then involved in forming the new squadron. So a few pilots he knows, many he knows by reputation, but, you know, there's some he's flying with. They start arriving at Scampton, and we're just going to play a clip now of this is where the squadron are first gathered together, and this is what Guy Gibson's able to tell them.
Well, here we are all together for the first time. You're wondering what it's all about, and I can't tell you because I don't know myself.
It's interesting that Gibson meets Wallace, who is absolutely perplexed that when he finds out that Gibson doesn't even know the target, although the crews have already started flying very low over water at night. So they're practicing, but they don't know what they're practicing for. You only tell those who need to know when they need to know it, and that's how the military works. So
exactly.
Gibson starts to attend, is that, how's it pronounced, Reculver?
Yeah, Reculver. It was the bombing range that they used for the practice drops.
So Gibson starts attending the practice drops. But you see this in the film, and I think they do a very good job. When the bombs hit the surface of the water, they keep breaking up. So obviously that part of the plan is not moving forward. Wallace asks Gibson if he could fly even lower. And they're already terrified already. Gibson replies that there's really no way of telling how exactly high they're flying at night because they don't have any kind of reference. So we'll try it, but obviously it's making him very nervous. And this is the part of the movie, unfortunately, where it's not exactly accurate, but it makes for good storytelling. On the way back to Scrampton, they stop in London to take in a show, and Gibson sees the spotlights down on the stage, and he has an idea. So, and we'll get to this in a moment, but basically it's his way of trying to solve the height, knowing what height they are in the plane and when they're in the Lancasters. So now, theoretically, they can fly at 60 feet over the water accurately, stay steady, which is what they need for the bombs to stay together.
They now start having successful trials. The bombs stay together, and there's a huge sort of, there's a lovely scene where Wallace and Gibson are dancing around, you know, hooting and hugging each other. Reality check, going back to the Guy Gibson bit, he was shown with the crew ending the tour and then all volunteering with him to go to the new squadron. In reality, only his radio operator, Flying Officer Hutchison, went with him. And there might be a couple of reasons why. Mm-hmm. And the Gibson character, Very interesting character. He came from a very broken home. His mother was an alcoholic. He was unremarkable at school, either academically or sportingly, but he became obsessed with flying, and he joined the RAF in 36, 37. So he was already a pilot when they started. But he was 24 at the time of the dams raid. So he was a very young man. He completed 72 missions at this stage, which statistically was 2.5 times what anyone should have survived. So quite remarkable. But what we're going to listen to now is Johnny Johnson, who was the bomb aimer on Joe McCarthy's Lancaster on the raid, and it was a sergeant, joined the squadron, and this is his thoughts on Guy Gibson.
I have to say that my appreciation of Gibson has to be retrospective, because at the time he was a squadron commander, I was a lowly sergeant, and one of his greatest problems was that he could not bring himself down to communicate with lower ranks. He could communicate very easily with the higher ups, higher than himself particularly, and with the more senior of the serving officers. But he had great difficulty in coming down to any other level at all. Arrogant, he was bombastic, he was a little man. It's surprising how often little men get that sort of attitude, but one had to accept that at that time he was one of, if not the most experienced bomber pilot in bomber command. He'd already done two tours, and he'd done tours on night fighters as well. So he had something to be arrogant about. But I think his true leadership qualities became more prevalent when he joined the, when he formed 617 Squadron, in that he realised he'd got to get more out of the crews than he might have from a normal squadron. So he calmed down a little bit. I think his true leadership qualities were shown on the actual raid itself, where he made the first attack on the Moan Dam, because that was the only one that was defended. We knew it was defended, so he, apart from dropping his bomb, he assessed the defence at the same time. And then, as he called each aircraft in turn, he flew alongside them to detract some of that defence, which to me says, you're doing this, I'm doing this, we're doing this together. And that, to me, is the essence of good leadership, leading from the front. He always did. He had his troubles, but he, in the actual fact, he was a great leader.
So amazingly, Gibson, and this is what shocked me, was only 24 years old at the time. He's a wing commander with full 3 tours under his belt. He's been awarded the DSO and bar, DFC and bar. So it's a pretty amazing for a guy that age. But as you look back on the war, you know, war is a young man's business. So a lot of these very young people are given incredible amounts of responsibility. Certainly something I couldn't have handled at that age. But getting into some of the crew, Johnny Johnson's pilot was an American, Flight Lieutenant Joe McCarthy, who had been raised on Long Island and joined the RCFA in May of 1941, remaining with the RCFA or /RAF after America's entry into the war. Already a DFC holder at the time of the dams raid, he received the DSO for Operation Chastise, then a bar to the DFC in 1944. Johnson speaks very highly of him in his autobiography. McCartney ended the war as a wing commander. So again, very young men being given tremendous amounts of responsibility, but they come through because they have a very intense sense of duty and loyalty.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Joe McCarthy's mentioned in the movie. He's the blonde beach guard, as they call him, or something. You know, but yeah, because a lot of Americans joined the Royal Canadian Air Force, came across the RAF to fight the Germans, or just because they were natural adventurers. But most of them, I mean, there were Americans who fought in the Battle of Britain in Fighter Command. Most of them, when America joined the war, then transferred to the USAAF, as it was then. But no, McCarthy stayed.
Yeah. That's yeah, there's a lot of people, they were, like you said, they were adventuresome, or some of them just had a sense of right and wrong, and obviously what the Nazis were doing was wrong. I find it really interesting in the movie, they're having briefings, but obviously there's not a lot to talk about, because one, they don't know very much that's going on, and two, even if they knew, they certainly weren't allowed to talk about it. So there's a lot of speculation going on. What's their target? What's they going to do? Some of them were thinking that the German ship Tirpitz was going to be their target. So again, there's just rumors and gossip all over the place. But Kipson keeps the security tight. One officer is heard on the phone talking to his girlfriend, saying that he couldn't meet her later that night because something was on, and he's instantly disciplined. So again, they were just keeping this very tight because, like you said earlier, this was Britain's really only way of hitting back at Germany, and so they were obviously taking it very seriously. Did we cover enough about the lights?
The height keeping with spotlights is true, but it wasn't discovered or thought of by Guy Gibson by watching a show. Mm. And actually, the movie sort of skirts around that because they have him watching the show and looking at spotlights.
Right.
And then the next scene is Barnes Wallace. He says to Barnes Wallace, "We solved the problem. We just shine two spotlights down, triangulated to meet. The two lights meet at 60 feet, and there you go." And Barnes Wallace says, "How did you think of that?" He said, "Oh, it was simple. We just gave the problem to the guys at Farnborough and they worked it out." Actually, that way of keeping your height over smooth water had already been established by Coastal Command. But the theatre show might be the inspiration for the real inventor, right. But that was already established. So, you know, the movie doesn't say that Guy Gibson invented it. It just implies it.
Right, right.
Now, obviously, a key thing in this film that a lot of people, particularly today, talk about is his dog. He did have a black Labrador. It followed him everywhere. It was a real character in the squadron. Other pilots would stand the Labrador a pint in the mess, and he enjoyed it. His name is incredibly unfortunate to modern ears, and it's a very, very racist and disparaging term. So we will simply refer to it as Gibson's dog. I mean, what Peter Jackson and Stephen Fry do with it, I don't know. Right. I just think for most modern people, that word is beyond the pale, and it's a word that should be consigned to history. But those like us who stand in the look, you know, you shouldn't judge people from the past by today's moral standards. I think we shouldn't necessarily think that Guy Gibson's a bad person because he had a
right.
The dog was black. But equally, for those who stand firmly in there, this is history, should be portrayed accurately, don't underestimate the fact that that word was just as disparaging and offensive in the 40s as it is today. It's just today, the vast majority of us refuse to accept that kind of language.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, well, back to the movie and the pre-mission and flight to the dams.
Yeah, so the mission, obviously, there's a lot of things they're going to need. They're going to need clear skies. They're going to need a full moon to get as much light as they can. But here's the important thing. They're going to need the level of the water at the dam at the time to be very high to help with the bombs, to get the bombs where they need to be. So this obviously gives them a very short window of only a few days, which happened to be in mid-May of 1943. And if they don't get it within that time, they're going to have to wait a full year for all those conditions to cycle around one more time. So the other squadrons based at Scampton. Now I'm an American. What's taking the Mickey?
Taking a piss.
Okay. So I guess they're giving them a train. I guess they're giving the training crews a hard time because they're not actually out bombing, risking their lives, striking at the enemy.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And some of the flight commanders complained to Gibson, and this happened apparently in reality, and said, look, some of our guys are getting a bit miffed at every time they come into the mess. It's, oh, sorry, what you chaps going to do when you wear out those armchairs? I think that's the line used in the movie. And Gibson apparently says to them, oh, go and blow off steam. So now, they have a riot.
So here's the part that you and I joked about this before the show, about the way that Gibson, the actor, talks during, I mean, it's pretty much over the top. Look here, see here, everybody, this is what we're going to do today. You know, it's like 1940s or whatever. And they're always standing around with their hands on their hips. I just think it's pretty funny. But at this moment, they drop all of that and they go after him. So all of Gibson's men, they're pretty much yelling, come on, chaps, off of their bags or off of their trousers. So here you have these grown men who are running around this mess hall, trying to wrestle each other to the ground to take off each other's pants. I'm just going to leave that one right there. But it was all in good fun, because no one's like really getting hurt. They're not getting hit over the head with bottles and stuff like that. But it's just good nature blowing off steam. And I can totally see that.
Well, to help with the bandwidth issues, we're not doing video. And if we were, Ray, you'd have seen, as a former Army senior NCO, you'd have seen my eyebrows go through my hairline, which is quite receded. When you described RAF officers as grown men. Okay. Yeah, not well, sure. I'm, no, that's just a bit of intercept fancy. Yeah, basically.
Physically. They are physically grown. In any other way, I'll leave that up to someone else. But yeah, so they blow off a little statement because, you know, everybody has their pride and everybody is risking their lives. And it does look like that these men are not, you know, that they're not doing anything. They're just flying around practicing. No one knows what they're doing. So it just looks bad. And then they have to get back some of their own and get some revenge by tearing off the trousers of other people. Completely normal.
Well, I was going to say, we haven't really gone into it here, but there is the comedy bit in the film of the poultry farmer who writing the letter to his MP. I would like to complain, sir, about these hooligans in the RAF who should be off fighting a war, and instead they're shoreboating and they're upsetting my hens to lay premature eggs which fall off perch and smash. You know, and he's, I've experienced it. I've experienced people with, flying complaints, the bane of any aviation organisation. But during this riot, Gibson gets a message that the station commander's outside. He pops out and he says, "Goodness me, guy, what's going on in there?" "Oh, nothing, sir. One of the chaps from 57 Squadron gobbed off a bit too often." And they both stood their hands on hips, leaning back, probably. And he says, and then, but this is the thing that gets me. Like you were saying earlier, great, you know, they're getting briefings on what they need to practice, but not why they're practicing it. It must be so frustrating. Having existed in you know, army crew rooms and aircrew rooms, and before that, you know, just in troop offices and garage vehicle parks and the like, the servicemen, like anyone else, rumour control rules the roost. And, you know, goodness knows what they would come up with, where they were going to go and attack. He then gathers the men and says, "Right, we're going to tell you what it is." And so you have the briefing where they're finally being told, "This is where we're going, and it's tonight." You know, the night before, the station commander says, "It's going to be tomorrow night." He gets them all together. And then I remember the first time I saw this film as a kid, and the camera kept cutting away to Gibson's dog, and it's running up, and there's air crewmen going, "Hello, mate. All right, boy." "Yeah. Oh, no, he's not here. I don't know where he is." And then he runs off to the guard room. And then you don't see anything, but you just hear a squeal of brakes and someone shouting the dog's name. Then you cut back to the air crew getting their briefing. And there's a lot on the pre-mission rituals. You know, some of the guys go for a snooze. Some of the guys have a cup of tea. Some of them have a cigarette. Mm-hmm. You know, some of them do all three at once. And people getting their little lucky charms and tucking them in their flying suits. And then Gibson's Batman says to him, says he's very sorry, but his dog's been killed. And it is really quite moving, and very sadly, it is absolutely true. And Guy Gibson asks a flight sergeant if he can bury the dog at midnight, because that's about when they'll be going in. And then we see them taking off into the night sky.
Yeah. Let me ask you, as a pilot, I mean, you just really get the sense that these guys are just looking, hoping for anything to be a good sign that they're going to make it through the latest mission. You just get the sense that a lot of these guys, for whatever reason, are superstitious. And the idea that this guy's dog dies on the day that he's about to fly out on this very dangerous mission. I mean, flying low at night is dangerous enough as it is, much less going after these dams. But you just get the sense like this is foreboding something really bad is about to happen.
Yeah, but I think if it wasn't true, then Hollywood could have put this in to demonstrate the bullheaded determination of this particular man. And I think going back to Johnny Johnson's thing earlier, he said you cannot deny his courage, his leadership skills. He led from the front. We'll see later on he puts himself in he's always in the position of greatest danger. If someone else has to share it, he's going to make damn sure he shares it. He's not, you know, he's not leading from the rear at all. And I think this is just his such a focus, or he was maxed out. Maybe he just had so much he'd given to the mission, he didn't have time for his thoughts and emotions about his dog. And, you know, knowing how attached we become to pets, they become members of our family. Mm-hmm. And they knew what they were going up against. I mean, you've talked about when we were emailing beforehand, the Kammhuber line, which Hermann Göring was the colonel or the general who had to come up with this. This was the German air defenses, I think.
Yeah, so they had massive guns on the coast. They had massive guns around the dams, and they have massive guns around Essen and the Ruhr Valley and stuff like that. And they also have the Freya radar stations, which were in some ways superior to Britain's radar. And again, so that's why they're going to have to fly, as we're going to see, they're going to have to fly very low the entire way there just to have a chance to make it to their... To their goal. So again, they all know how dangerous this is. And I'm sitting here thinking about the dog. If this had happened on any other day, Gibson would have had plenty of time to mourn the loss of his dog. But he's got the lives of all of these men hanging on his shoulders. He has got to stay focused. He can't fall apart. And again, that just adds to the poignancy of losing his pet, his beloved pet.
Absolutely. I mean, bomber crews suffer the second highest casualty proportions after submarine and specifically U-boat crews. And although casualties on raids generally were 4-5%, that's cumulative. So yeah. Only 1 in 5 bomber crew would survive 2 full operational tours. Gibson was most of his way through a third one. I mean, the flight over there, I looked at it from the perspective of having flown Lynx helicopters in the British Army. Mm-hmm. And I've flown on plenty of multi-mission exercises at night, keyword there being exercises.
Right.
One in particular had parallels with this because we went on a 5-hour mission in Scotland on training exercise, but 5 hours is greater than a Lynx's maximum endurance. So during that 5 hours, we actually landed and met a Chinook helicopter, which had fuel bladders on board and refueled us. Mm-hmm. And we were flying at about 100 to 120 knots, not over 200. And we had radio altimeters, which tell you precisely how high you are above the ground or obstacles. Right. And although our primary navigation tools were prepared maps and compasses, we also had GPS to confirm our routing. But above all, we had night vision goggles so we could see. If anyone's ever watched, if they're not sure what I'm talking about or what I mean, if you ever watched one of these wildlife programs where they're filming lions at night and it's all greens and blacks right. and grays, that's what we see. But it is like watching a black and white film, you know, with a good moon, you got really good quality vision at night with night vision goggles. And we have really accurate maps that tell us exactly where all the wires are. And of course, the final point and probably the most important, no one was shooting at us.
Right.
So what these crews achieve purely from an aviation perspective is incredible.
Yeah.
Absolutely remarkable.
So they fly low at night over the water the entire way there. That's dangerous enough as it is. And you've got to think it's going to take a while to get there. Monotony can set in. You can get bored. You can, you know, maybe make a tiny mistake while you're flying. So it was a very risky thing just getting over there in the first place. So obviously in the film, they're going to focus on Gibson's formation and the other two Vicks of the three heading to the, is it the Mon Dam? Is that how you say it?
Mona Dam.
Thank you. All right. So we see one of the aircraft crash en route, just to show you how dangerous this all is. But Guy Gibson does arrive, and he goes straight into his first attack. And like you said before, this is someone who leads from the front. He can have all the faults that he wants as a human being, as a civilian. But obviously, when it comes to this, he is a true leader, and he's going to go in first. So his bomb hits the dam, but the dam holds. So obviously their plans are going awry right from the beginning. So there's tension back at H quarters in Grantham. Because over there, you've got Barnes Wallace, you've got Arthur Harris, along with other senior military officials, and they're receiving radio messages in Morse code, and they're being given over a telephone, so they're being literally given an update as each bomb drops. And the movie switches back to the attacking aircraft, back to headquarters, back and forth. So I thought it was interesting. This is the best part of the movie. They really go into detail. They slow it down. They give you a really good idea of the attack. And Gibson and Hopgood makes his attack, but for Hopgood, he comes in too fast. His mine bounces over the dam and explodes under Lancaster. And then you hear, and this is the tragic part of the film, but there's going to be more. Hopgood is heard faintly calling out that he thinks he's okay, because right after he drops his bomb, he has to pull up on the plane just to clear a nearby hill. And there's an explosion, so obviously his plane doesn't make it, and everybody with him perishes.
I mean, there's a couple more successful attacks later. Mm-hmm. The HQ room, I think they portray that really well, the tension, messages are coming in, gonna. And the Morse is spot on. Before I was flying in the Army, I was in the Signal Corps, and we learned Morse. So I listened quite carefully the first time I saw Dambusters after having done my Morse training. And it's like, yeah, it's spot on. And they send gonna, and then they send did it, which is two eyes, and it's a holding. It's like a wait.
Right.
Wait. And then they go did it, which is AR barred, which is it's an A did R and a R did R it all together. And that means out, end of message. So they keep knowing, okay, this is now four bombs have successfully been dropped. Still, the bomb hasn't gone. But as the next Lancaster lines up, you suddenly hear someone going, skipper, it's gone. And the code word sent back is, unfortunately, the name of Gibson's late dog. Right. But they go wild. They go wild in the HQ room. Now, what I found fascinating was after Gibson had dropped his, he then realizes the flak's a bit heavier than expected. And James Holland's book reveals that actually the Germans had stripped some of the guns off the dams, thinking they're never going to attack here. Okay. We've got anti-torpedo nets and everything. They didn't think they'd be able to. So some of the big guns had been taken away, but the flak was still quite heavy. So Gibson flies in with the next attacking aircraft over and over again. Yes. To draw the fire, and then he orders someone else to do it, and you can hear them going, what, really? Okay, damn. I do love an aggressive squadron leader, don't you, chappies? But yeah, they're flying in and to draw the fire away, so the German defenders, you know, they haven't split their fire two or three ways. And then when the Mona Dam goes, he says, right, everyone who's empty, go home, see you later. Rest of you, follow me. And then he leads them to the Ada Dam, which is their secondary target.
Right.
And the process is repeated. Only two successful drops, but a large breach opens in the Ada as well. And then finally, we see Guy Gibson leading the remainder of that group home. I just had a little hiccup then.
Okay. And if we could just stop for a second, and for all you Star Wars fans out here, I completely was shocked because I knew that when George Lucas made Star Wars, that he took reels from World War II, you know, but there is actual dialogue in this film that Star Wars bars. How many guns do you see on the tower? Just like out of Star Wars, and the flag's pretty heavy, and just there's like three or four lines that come right from Star Wars, right from this movie. So again, I just that was pretty cool. But yeah, you're absolutely right. Gibson goes in, his bomb detonates as it's supposed to, but it's not strong enough. He's going to lead the other guys in, basically, you know, trying to draw the other guys' fire. He's going to be a target for them, so they're hopefully their planes can have a little steadier path when they go in. And he does this over and over again. I mean, you do not get any more courageous / suicidal than that. I was just impressed by his cojones.
The crews fly home, and we see Gibson's aircraft landing, and it sort of implies that dawn's approaching. It was actually about 3 o'clock in the morning he got back. Right. But the last crews are landing around dawn, and they go into the mess, and you can see them a little bit shell-shocked, a little bit disorientated. They're being debriefed already by intelligence officers. They're grabbing tea and toast, and then they go into their rooms and lie down. Then they cut to some other rooms which are absolutely empty and silent, and there are batmen pausing thoughtfully before they close the door, and there's letters left against, you know, desk lights, desk lamps, clearly to be sent to the next of kin in the event of. And then the film cuts to what I think is the original news broadcast that went out to Britain and the Allies on their, you know, BBC radios the next morning.
This is London. The Air Ministry have just issued the following communique. In the early hours of this morning, a force of Lancasters of Bomber Command, led by Wing Commander G.P. Gibson, DSO, DFC, attacked with mines the dams of the Myrna and Sauber reservoirs. These control two-thirds of the water storage capacity of the Ruhr Basin. Reconnaissance later established that the Myrna Dam had been breached over a length of 100 yards and that the power station below had been swept away by the resulting floods. The Ada Dam, which controls the headwaters of the Weser and Fulda valleys and operates several power stations, was also attacked and was reported as breached. Photographs show the river below the dam in full flood. the attacks were pressed home from a very low level with great determination and coolness in the face of fierce resistance. 8 of the Lancasters are missing.
I just thought it was, again, very poignant when Barnes Wallace sees Gibson. He runs up to him, and they just have this moment where one guy is excited that it's over with, and the other guy, the civilian, is about to learn the truth of war, and it just rocks him to his core.
Is it true? All those fellows lost. Only 2 aircraft went down in the attacks. That was Hopgood's over the Mur and Maudsley's over the Ada. Astor got it soon after crossing the coast, and Bingy Young was shot down over the sea on his way home. The rest we don't know about. They've been calling them since midnight, but they haven't answered. The flak was bad, worse than I expected.
56 men. If I'd known it was going to be like this, I'd never have started it.
Now, you mustn't think that way. If all these fellows had known from the beginning they wouldn't be coming back, they'd have gone for it just the same. There isn't a single one of them would have dropped out. I knew them all. I know that's true. Look, you've had a worse night than any of us. Why don't you go and find the doctor and ask for one of his sleeping pills?
Aren't you going to turn in, Gibby?
No, I have to write some letters first.
Yeah, I think he was horrified that something he'd invented had led men to have to go and do what they'd done. And you know, 8 out of 19 Lancasters didn't come back. And that's pretty much that bit at the end with Gibson just saying, when Barnes Wallace says, "Are you going to get some sleep then, Gibby?" And he said, "No, I've got some letters to write," and roll credits.
Right.
On the reality check, there's no coverage at all in the movie, really, of the attack that went to the Sorpa Dam. This was of earth construction, needed a different type of bomb attack. Joe McCarthy's was the only one of 5 aircraft to reach the dam and attack it on the first wave. And Johnny Johnson, heard earlier in the clip we had about Gibson, he was his bomb owner. He refused to drop on the first 9 port passes because this was the one where they have to come in over. There was a church or a monastery, I think. They have to dive down, and he just didn't keep getting it right. On the 10th attempt, they said, "Yep, got it." They did a lot of damage, but didn't actually breach it.
Right.
Of the other 4 aircraft, 2 were lost, 1 to pylons, 1 to enemy fire. 2 more turned back. 1 lost their bomb when they clipped the sea. They were that low on the way out.
Wow.
And so there's no point in continuing. And the other one was damaged by flak. Then from the 3rd wave, Ken Brown's aircraft made it to the Sorpa, saw the damage McCarthy had done, made their own attack again after several runs. There was mist forming by now. This is the early hours of the morning. So Ken Brown had his crew drop incendiary flares so he'd have a marker for subsequent attack runs. I mean, these guys were so dedicated. Eventually, they were happy, dropped their bomb, caused yet more damage, but again, no breach, flew back. Yeah, the reality of what happened at the Mona, which will lead into our conclusion, or will have a link to the conclusion.
Right. So as far as Hopgood's aircraft... we're not sure if it was a AA fire or whatever, but so the plane ends up crashing, but not before the pilot, officers Frazier and Booker, are able to bail out. They do survive and they're captured, and they swore that Hopgood Zoom climbed the dying aircraft to give them a chance. So again, just looking after each other, willing to sacrifice their own lives to save their mates. It doesn't get any more braver than that. Estelle's aircraft had crashed on the way to the dam, hitting power lines. Dingy Young and Maudsley's aircraft were shot down on the way home. And sadly, there were no survivors from any of these crews. Burpley and Otley, both from the 3rd wave, were shot down on their way to their targets. Sergeant Freddie Tees was the only survivor, climbing from Otley's crashed plane with several burns, but he did survive. And as we said earlier, Barnes Wallace was horrified, absolutely horrified by the loss of so many crews. Like you said, 8 of 19 Lancasters failed to return, 56 men lost, 3 subsequently discovered to have survived as POWs, but still, for this civilian who thought he was going to arrange something that would cause the Germans a lot of damage, but not to the British, he was absolutely shocked by the results.
Yeah, and it's, of course, we do have to consider as well the German casualties. Harder to estimate. Most reports say 1,400 to 1,600 killed, but over half of them forced labor and prisoners of war from occupied European countries.
Yeah.
The damage to the Ruhr's industrial efficiency was maybe not as great as been hoped by the Allies. Barnes-Wallace believed for years that Bomber Command missed an opportunity to launch heavy conventional raids to hinder the rebuilding process. Mm. However, James Holland argues quite convincingly there was actually a huge amount of secondary effect to the raid. Labels diverted from the Atlantic wall defences that would, had just been started. Other projects were stripped of manpower. A lot of resources went into rebuilding the dams, which were these huge... And this was the Empire State Building to Germany. People go and see this iconic tourist attractions. The other thing was that it hindered production of fuel and lubricants for the upcoming German offensive against the Russians at Kursk. And for your listeners, right, spoiler alert, that's a battle they go on to lose.
Right.
Photographs taken the following morning by a high-flying photo reconnaissance Spitfire flying by Flight Lieutenant Jerry Raffray showed an enormous lake, and he said he was overcome by the results of the raid. You know, the bombing campaigns over Europe and Germany in World War II are very controversial. A lot of people have cast aspersions on Bomber Harris's character. I think they're missing the point. He was a military commander, he was given a task, and as we've seen with him, even if he didn't agree with it, if he was told, look, shut up and get on with it, he'd do everything he could to make sure it succeeded. Guy Gibson may not have been as likable a character as Richard Todd portrays, but it always surprises me when people want their war heroes to also be nice and fluffy.
Yeah.
The characteristics that make them war heroes often means they quite like fighting, which doesn't always make them particularly nice people. It just makes them very, very effective.
Yeah. And that's just the reality, and that's not going to change anytime soon. As far as 617 Squadron, they were continue their special status, being given a variety of specialist missions throughout the rest of the war. They, along with 9 Squadron Lancasters, attacked and sank the Tirpitz, which obviously Germany was worried about, because that was Germany's most powerful surface vessel, and it was sank in a Norwegian Ford 18 months after the dam attacks. The bombs were used there were the Tall Boys, a huge bomb designed by Barnes-Wallace, who had also designed the even bigger Grand Slam, and these were the evolutions from his original Earthquake bomb. Now, ironically, considering the efforts made to cripple her and the concern she caused the Admiralty, the Tirpitz had hardly ever fired its main armaments other than in training. The only other time it fired its main armaments was against the Lancaster bombers that eventually sank her. So, ironically, it caused the Admiralty a lot of headaches, but it didn't actually affect in the war in that in the sense that they were worried about. Yeah, Barnes-Wallace was truly devastated by the loss of so many crews, but, and they show this in the film, he was consoled by Gibson, but still he remains quite shocked and saddened by the casualties. So again, this is someone who spends a lot of time thinking, a lot of time in the lab, a lot of time doing experiments, and not dealing with the realities of the war. But that's the way it is. Later, Wallace was to receive a telegram from ACM Harris, Bomber Harris. The CNC may have been strongly opposed to this idea at first, and he did remain skeptical right up until the raid itself. But once told by Portal to go ahead, he had done everything in his power to make it happen, and that's the type of person Harris was. Harris writes, "But for your knowledge, skill, and persistence, often in the face of discouragements and disappointments in the design, production, and servicing of the equipment used in the destruction of the dams, the efforts of our gallant crews would have been in vain. We in Bomber Command in particular, and the United Nations as a whole, owe everything to you in the first for the most outstanding success achieved." So again, Bomber Harris was a very practical man. He was a very tight-lipped man, but he was able to give credit where credit was due. Wallace had served his country well.
Yeah, and Guy Gibson was awarded the Victoria Cross, Britain's highest military award, and he became something of a celebrity. You can find videos on YouTube of him addressing a Boy Scout group. He meets King George V and presents the crews, and he was encouraged to write a book, which he did. It was published in 1946 and entitled Enemy Coast Ahead. And the last part of the book reflects Gibson's confidence that he would now survive the war, and he kind of wonders why he should when so many other people didn't, mm-hmm. and especially when he pushed so hard to lead from the front for so long. He was touring the US and Britain after the dams raid and kept pleading to be allowed to return to a frontline role. His requests were sort of approved, but actually he wasn't really meant to go on raids, and he kept doing it sort of unofficially. And sadly, in September 1944, him and his co-pilot or his navigator were in a Mosquito. They'd been out, they'd successfully completed their pathfinding mission, and they crashed over the Netherlands on the homeward leg and were both killed. The official version is either he ran out of fuel, which is highly unlikely due to his experience and skill, and even if he had done, if it had been damaged, a man of his ability should have been able to make a forced landing in the area where he crashed, or he was flying very low and was hit by ground fire. However, the conspiracy thing is a rumour persisted that he may have been shot down by returning Lancaster. And in 1992, a former flying sergeant, Bernard McCormack, died, and a recording had been left that he said, don't release it till after I died. But he was a rear gunner on a returning Lancaster on the same night in the same area, and he thinks he mistook Guy Gibson's Mosquito for a Junkers 88 night fighter and engaged it with tragic success. Once he learned what he may have done, he kept quiet. Now, it's not clear whether he was told to, if he reported it, or if he and his crew just kept it to themselves. But obviously, given Guy Gibson's status, he didn't really want to say, hey, excuse me, I think I might have just shot him down.
Yeah.
But he left these details after he died in 92. We'll probably never know.
Right.
What I would say is, if you do want a very readable and very detailed and balanced account of it, I can't recommend James Holland's book, The Dambusters, highly enough. But neither, for a rip-roaring read, can I recommend Paul Brickhill's original Dambusters book or Enemy Coast Ahead, if only for the pathos of knowing that Guy Gibson didn't actually survive it. It's really quite sad.
Yeah.
And he had a complicated private life as well, which there's no need to go into here, but basically he was married, not very happily, but he had a companion, a lady companion.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think anything physical happened, but they had a dream of living in Honeysuckle Cottage, which was their little dream cottage they'd escaped to when they were together. But the last postscript, I think, is happy. John Fraser, who was the young officer in Hoppy Hopgood's Cripple Lancaster, who successfully bailed out and is convinced that Hoppy saved his life by basically using what remained of kinetic energy in the aircraft to climb 300 or 400 feet to give him a chance of bailing out.
Mm.
He survived the war, and John Fraser moved to Canada with his young family, and they named their daughter Cher after the village where Hopgood grew up and was always talking about. Sadly, John Fraser was killed in a flying accident in 62, but many years later, during the filming of a documentary about the raid, Cher Fraser Lowe met Joe McCarthy Jr., who was by then, I believe, a retired US Navy fighter pilot and the son of Joe McCarthy, who successfully attacked the Sorpy Dam. And these two children of Dambusters were married in 2010.
Wow.
And at the time of James Holland writing his book, they were living very close to John Fraser's widow, Doris, in Canada. And I just thought, there's a lovely symmetry to that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm very conscious that we're giving a very allied perspective to this raid. But then I suppose that's kind of inevitable, you know, because we're talking about a film which was virtually completely from the allied perspective.
Yeah, but just to be fair, I mean, if one side, Germany, starts the war, can't exactly complain about what happens to you after that. And again, and you can't stress this enough, there was no way Britain had the ability to land on mainland Europe and take the fight to the Germans. This was all they had at the time until events were to change, until circumstances were to change, and they were going to make the best of it. And that is what you do in war.
Certainly. And watching some of the documentaries, because the Al Alamein victory had happened a week or two before the dams raids,
mm-hmm.
3 years of we're getting beaten. Okay, right. We survived the Battle of Britain, but that's like sort of backs against the wall, survived. That wasn't, it was a victory tactically, but strategically we were still penned in our island. We were getting knocked back in the Far East by the Japanese when they came in. It just seemed it was doom and gloom. And I mean, my father was six when the war broke out, and he talked about being a young kid. And it's so weird for us to look back. We have this time category, 39 to 45. That was the Second World War, and it fitted into that time slot. In 41, 42, 43, before you know, this was it.
Yeah.
This was going to go on for decades, or we were going to lose. We didn't know.
Yeah.
And I just find it incredible that actually this spring in North Africa on the ground and in the bombing raids and the morale effect of the Dambusters raid cannot be overhyped, I don't think.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, you know, for people at home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I was just going to say, I mean, you're absolutely right. I mean, Britain's, you know, between 41 and 43, all Britain can claim is that, hey, we're not out of it yet. We haven't lost yet. I mean, forget surviving, forget winning. We just currently haven't lost. I mean, and to do that for 3 years, you can't remember life before that. And to have something like this happen where you can actually strike back at the enemy. I mean, and
yeah.
London obviously used it as propaganda, but just grabbing onto anything to make it look like, hey, maybe this one day will end. You have to be excited about that.
Yeah, and of course, for Britain, it was 39 to 43. We've been in it for a couple of years already.
Sorry, yeah, I missed a couple of years there.
Not a huge amount happened. I mean, they called it the phony war from September 39, when the war was declared, to really the spring of 40 and the German offensive through the Ardennes. The only things that had happened up to then was Poland. And that's a subject for another... probably when we do Battle of Britain, to get into how the West have completely stripped Poland of the credit they deserve. And we might have to do a supplementary edition for that. And it's not just because Andrew, my co-host, is a Australian of Polish descent, but this is something I felt passionate about for years.
It's a legitimate concern.
One day I'm going to get on a soapbox and have an absolutely massive rant and start telling people the things that we're not taught as kids, though.
Absolutely.
Two high scoring RAF squadrons in the Battle of Britain, both Polish. By a country mile, they knocked the British squadrons into a cocked hat and they didn't even join in till halfway through.
Yeah.
You know, who took Monte Cassino when the Americans had failed, the British had failed, the Australians had failed? Oh, that would be the Polish people, the Polish Second Army Corps, most of whom had walked from Siberia to Palestine to get there and join them. You know, we'd all know at some stage, no doubt, we'll cover U571. We are moving away from Dambusters here, but we will cover U571, whose tagline of the movie, I believe, is, "Nine men are about to change history." And you're like, you're not kidding, mate.
Exactly.
You are about to change history. Because every English schoolboy knows the first Enigma machine was captured by HMS Walker months before America joined the war. But actually, no, we're wrong as well. Because the first Enigma machine was captured by Polish cryptographers from the Germans, and they took it to London. So our people knew what to look for. But we've taken that credit away from them.
Yeah.
We're such propagandists, all of us, in our own countries. Anyway... Sorry, I'm going off. This is going to be the longest show we've done yet anyway. And we need to give this marks out of 10. And I think we're pretty much in agreement here, aren't we?
Absolutely, yeah. When it comes to entertainment, I mean, this was just an absolute... Besides everybody standing around with their hands on their hips and talking like they're giving a speech, it was an absolute corker of a film. Give it a 9 for entertainment. I really enjoyed it. Just sat there and watched the whole thing, and just from the get-go, enjoyed all of the detail, all of the emotion in it, and the poignancy and everything. It was just a very entertaining film.
I can become quite emotional watching this film because it doesn't try to pluck my heartstrings. It makes no overt effort to pluck my heartstrings. Eric Coates' music will do it for me every time, and you could say that is, but it's just, I think it states the facts and leaves you to interpret what those facts mean. Historical accuracy, pretty for a mainstream film, this is about as close as you're going to get. There were a few bits, mainly as devices changed. Can't go lower than an 8. But just in case we do one day come across a film that actually virtually gets everything right, can't really go higher than an 8. So I think we've both come down on entertainment, 18 out of 20. Historical accuracy, 16 out of 20, pretty darn good. And yes, it's black and white. Yes, the people do speak with that sort of strange, pathé news voices sometimes. Even the NCOs speak as if they're just going to finishing school. I mean, final thoughts, brilliant film. Really enjoyed researching it. Found out quite a lot of stuff I didn't know before, which I really should have done. And looking forward to... 2 weeks' time, when we're examining three movies. How are we going to find time for this? I don't know. I shouldn't complain. I'm only doing one podcast these days. But we've got three movies to watch, all of which take slightly different approaches to portraying a conflict in a very different era and in a very small, confined space, namely all aboard one ship as we look at the Mutiny on the Bounty. The Charles Laughton Clark Gable. Charles Laughton was Captain Bligh, and Clark Gable's Fletcher Christian from the 30s. Then the Trevor Howard as Captain Bligh, Marlon Brando as Fletcher Christian in the 60s. and then the 1980s Anthony Hopkins as Bligh and Mel Gibson as Fletcher Christian. So our first encounter with Mel Gibson, thankfully, didn't direct it, so it's not complete horse manure. But yeah, we'll be doing that in 2 weeks' time. Andrew will be rejoining us for that one, having enjoyed his break. What break? He's got to research 3 films. Ray, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you ever so much for joining us today. And I sincerely hope you'd said, if it's fun, I might consider coming back. I sincerely hope you have found it fun. We'll try and give you a bit of a break before we try and drag you back on again. But
yeah,
certainly, you know, you've got insights into eras that we could thoroughly enjoy and benefit from tapping into. So thank you so much. For people wanting to listen to your show, fire away and tell us what's the best way they can track you down and your World War II podcast.
Right. Well, technically,
or any of the other ones.
Well, technically, it's a History of World War II podcast.net. But if you just type in World War II podcast, because of all the great listeners out there, you can pretty much find it on any podcatcher that exists. It's been around for a while, so it's well established. Give it a listen. I think I've done 187 episodes, but I'm only up to December of 1941. Check it out if you want. But like you said, there's a History of Alexander, History of Caesar, History of Augustus, Cold War, The Three Illusions, and I feel like I'm forgetting something, but maybe not. Anyway,
The
BS filter, there we go, the brand new one.
Well,
but yeah,
you actually spell out BS.
Yeah, spell it out, but we're just going to say BS here because we're all gentlemen.
I mean, you're doing for World War II what and in an even greater deal than what Mike Duncan did for the History of Rome, which I think a lot of people see as that was one of the first epic series.
Right. That was my favorite.
But I'm so impressed that, and just to remind our listeners, Ray's not Canadian. No. Ray is American. He's from Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
Or you live in Virginia. So right. You're from South Carolina, aren't you? But you live in Virginia. But for an American, you're on episode 180 and you're in December 1941. That means you started in 39.
Exactly. So I'll be doing this
for
another
European
20
listeners,
years.
They'll be so impressed. But it also means, yeah, you are actually, this is like a series of 24, isn't it? You are actually
exactly
going through it.
That's what it feels like.
Real time.
Yeah. And that was the whole idea. I mean, we all know the broad strokes of World War II, but let's get into it. Let's get to the details. How and why did everything happen? And that's what I'm trying to explain.
That's what you guys do so well in all the history podcasts I've listened. And I listen to all of yours. I'm struggling for time myself. I take routes to work that take longer just so I can get a bit more of a podcast in. But no, it's been thoroughly enjoyable. I've got a heck of an edit job on now to drop all these sound clips, and I really must learn how to do that as we go along. Maybe you could ask Cameron for me. But Ray, thank you ever so much.
Thank you.
We will speak to you again, hopefully in the future.
All right, take care, everyone.
Thanks, buddy.